So I told a couple of the people who are here a little bit early, we're actually going to be doing some live demo. So let's all cross our fingers the Wi-Fi works. If it doesn't, I'll just describe it in detail what it should have looked like. And then you guys can ping me afterwards and I'll share it. So a little bit about myself. I'm a Salesforce MVP. I've been a consultant with Internet Creations for about 14 months now. Previous to that, I worked for a bank as their solo admin and did about 9 implementations by myself in 2.5 years. So I got a crash course in Salesforce from the very beginning. With community specifically, I've done 7 Napili template stand-ups in the last 6 months. So I've really broken a lot of things, and that's what this presentation is about. We're going to go through and first thank our sponsors for getting us here and all together. And the agenda today, we're going to talk about what's a community, what templates should we be choosing, but the primary focus today is going to be the Napili template because it's all about self-service for our customers. And then we're going to talk about watch-out slides, which is all the mistakes that I made, and then I'm going to show you how to fix them and or avoid them. And then deployments, they can be a little bit tricky, so we'll spend a little time talking about that. And then at the very end, I have about 2 full slides of just references. Lots of help and training links, trailheads, things that I think you could read further before you do your own implementation. So communities. Has anybody done communities before? Awesome, you guys are all experts. Why are you here? So the communities are just an extension of your Salesforce org, and it's going to let people external to your organization access your information. So it could be your customers, it could be partners. You can also have an employee version, which is like an intranet. And then I just have a quick slide on the evolution of the community cloud, and it's all leveraging things that we're already familiar with and then packaging them up into something that you can use declaratively. Whereas previously, to get a customer portal up, there was a lot of development that you needed. All right. So templates, which to choose. So the ones that are called tabs plus visual force are the ones that we know from beforehand. They look just like the normal login screen where you see all the tabs at the top, but it was just limited to what objects you're going to let your customers have. The Napili template is what's going to leverage mostly knowledge, cases, and questions and answers. Koa is the most mobile optimized, and it also has knowledge and cases. Kakua, I've never used personally, but according to the internet, it says knowledge and cases is what it has. And then Aloha is the identity one. So that's the one that's going to have different apps for single sign-on that you can leverage. And like I said, we're going to talk mostly about Napili. Who has the Community Cloud certification? Anybody? Nice. All right, so if you want the certification, focus almost solely on Napili. That's the most important and most heavily tested part of it. So again, that's why this talk is all about Napili. All right, so here are the main features of the Napili community. The first one is self-service. So the goal is to give access to knowledge articles, questions and answers, and cases to our customers. When they log in, they should be able to try to find the answer for themselves. If they can't find it, they can ask their community, and if that still doesn't work, then they can, of course, open a support case with you. You want to collaborate, which is leveraging Chatter, so you can use groups, customer groups. You can organize topics. We're going to do a little bit of that later. And then with the Community Builder, you can actually customize using already made Lightning components. You drag and drop and move them around the page. So we're going to do a little bit of that as well. And we're going to do it now. All right. So the first thing you want to do is turn on communities if you haven't already. Once you do this, you can't turn it off. You can certainly deactivate communities, but just make sure you're ready to commit. And always do this in the sandbox first. The maximum number of communities you can have right now just got increased to 100. And when you think about that limit, make sure that you're including that active, inactive, and communities in the preview mode all count against that limit. And of course, when you're ready to actually tick that box to enable, make sure you've really thought about what you want your domain to be. So that's going to be the customer-facing side of the website. They're always going, and you won't be able to change that domain once you get it started. And that'll be the domain for all of your communities. All right, so let's get this going. So community settings is where you go to actually set up the domain. You just tick off this box to enable it, and then you choose the domain. And there's actually a button to check the availability so you'll know if you can use it or not. Then once you get it saved, you have this section in the setup menu called All Communities that becomes available. And you click the New Community button. You choose your template. So these are the ones we were just talking about. Customer Service Napili is what we're using. Tabs and Visual Force was the original version of communities we were talking about. Koa, Kakua, and Aloha. So the name is going to be whatever you want it to be. It should be descriptive of what community you're standing up. And then the URL, this is the domain we were talking about that has to be unique and will be common across all your communities. And then at the end, you can label what the unique identifier is for this particular community. And then you create it. And then it just does all the work for you. So while that's loading, we're going to go talk about the first thing we're going to work on. So new to Spring 17, they made a couple of changes, and they introduced workspaces. And so workspaces are going to give you all of the different tools that you need in order to stand up a community. You've got the builder, which is going to be this really pretty drag-and-drop interface where we can set the colors that we want, we can upload our logo, we can move all the different lightning components around on the page. Moderation is where you monitor the posts and comments. You can create rules, which we're going to do a little bit of later, to either flag comments that we think are questionable, or we can block posts. It's a way for you to make sure that the people who are engaged on your community are doing it in the spirit that you want them to. Content targeting, that's where we're going to talk about topics. We can make navigational topics to sort of direct your users to the right spot for their questions and their conversations. Dashboards, of course, are dashboards. And then administration is where you always start. This is going to be the back end of all of the different settings. So I've highlighted for you the order that I do everything in. And I always start at administration, go to moderation, then we're going to build it out, dashboards, and finally the content targeting. Okay. So when you first set up the Napili template, it always takes you to the activation page. You're really tempted to click activate, but as soon as you activate it, it's public. Anybody that goes to that URL can now access your community, assuming they have a login. So before I activate, I always think about, am I going to have guest users? Is there going to be a public knowledge base? Because on this settings page, you're going to check off a box that says people are allowed to access this website without authentication or not. So let's go to the internet. Who can access the communities? So there's two different ways to grant access to a community. It's either through the profile or with a permission set. So the profile could be the customer community, but if you don't want all of your customers to have access to this community, maybe it's just a subset, you have a product-specific community, you could actually create a permission set called the SED community, and then everyone I assign that permission set would get access to it. So that would be one of these. And then I move it over. Now, before I click save, it's really important to go check out the emails section. And see this send welcome email? Every time you add in a new user, they're going to get a welcome email, which is great. If you already have a live Salesforce instance and you're turning on communities in production and you move those customer community profiles over and you say, save, these are members of the community, and you have this welcome email checked, you're going to email blast all the people that you just added to your community. So just before you do that, I always uncheck these welcome emails if I'm doing it in production and then save it. Then I can go to members, get them added, because that is embarrassing. And then we have another dumb thing that I did. So watch out. All right, this was like the first thing I did. I turned on my community, and I was trying to pull all of these profiles out because I didn't want people to see me making mistakes as I was learning how to use the builder. And so I came over to this multi-select pick list and I mass checked all the things that were not system administrator. Oh wait, now I grabbed system administrator and I threw it into available and click save. I locked myself out of the community. Took a little while to figure out, but I figured out how to fix it. So this is for you, my gift. If you lock yourself out, you don't have to tell anybody. You just use a data loader or something similar, like a jitterbit, and then you need the network ID and the parent ID, which, what are those? It's the community's unique ID, and then the parent ID is actually our profile for the system administrator profile. And then you just mass import that in, and it reassigns the relationship, and then you can log back into your community. So all of the instructions are right here for you. I hope you never do it. Okay. Here's another one that's really common. I've done all of the work, and I finally am ready to share it with my customers or my test users. And I send them the link, and I tell them to log in, and this is what they see. It's because I forgot to activate the community. Remember how I was like, don't do that at the beginning? Definitely do it at the end when you want people to use it. This one's a little tough to see, so we're going to zoom. Okay. So these are those, that email page I was talking about in administration. So the email address is going to be set up to whoever it was that first spun up the community, which in this case, you guys now all have my personal email. Please send me nice things. And so you can definitely change that because that's going to be the sender to all of our customers, but it has to be a verified email in Salesforce. So it'll just do a check in the background and make sure you're not trying to do support at Salesforce, something you're not supposed to. This right here, you can update the logo instead of using the Salesforce Chatter logo. This is actually in Documents. So if you go to the Documents tab and preload your logo, it'll be available there. And then these are just regular email templates. So once we spun up the Napili template, it actually created a folder for us and threw these standard communities templates in. So you can go in and edit them and put in custom messages. And we already talked about this. This is one of my watch out slides. Just make sure you've unchecked that welcome email whenever you're first onboarding or mass onboarding your users, unless you want them to get the email. All right. Moderation. We are cruising, y'all. Okay. So also new with Spring 17, this is a great time to get involved in communities. Salesforce has done a lot of the work for us. You already get these canned rules. And so I'm going to zoom in a little bit just so we can look at them. Can you guys read it in the back? Awesome. Okay. So Salesforce talked to a lot of their customers, and they just put together the most common rules that you would need. And so a lot of these are based on what types of information people are likely to try to post to a community or contribute that you may not want them to add. So the first one would be if you have a list of curse words, then you wouldn't want them to be able to post those things. So you could actually make a rule that says you're going to block posts or comments containing banned words. And there's actually an error message, so the offending user will be told why their post isn't coming through, and you can customize this message. I personally like the fact that it's referencing the bad word itself, so that as soon as they try to put it in there, it says, you can't say that. The other thing you can do with rules is instead of blocking it, which clearly tells the person they've done something wrong, you could instead flag the rule, which means it'll let the post go through, but then whoever's been assigned as a chatter moderator will get a list of people who've posted something questionable. So what I like to do when I'm implementing communities is I like to make a rule where the flagged words are actually a list of people's competitors. So we're not going to stop you from talking about the competition in our community, but I want my moderator to see what are the things they're talking about. Is it that Oracle's the worst, or you know, what is it that they're saying? So that way you can flag it and watch it. And you can make a rule for anything that you want. So those are moderation rules. Out of the box, you'll notice that all of these are not active. So you want to go through, review them, and then activate the ones that you want to use. So those are content type rules. The second type here are your rate rules. And those are meant to keep bots and other kind of spamming implements out of your community. So there's rules that actually review how often is somebody posting. And so in this case, we're going to freeze people and prevent them from accessing the community if they post. What are they doing? They create 10 posts in 3 minutes. You can make it 100 posts in 3 minutes. Of course, the odds of somebody being able to post 10 full things in 3 minutes is pretty slim. There's also a rate rule to prevent people from posting when they first join. You can make a rule that says, we're going to flag their first post so that I can review it first, make sure it's appropriate, and then we let them go on their way. So content criteria is where you'll actually load the words. Gotta love this disclaimer. This is from Salesforce saying, we don't know if it's all the bad words. If you Google like curse word CSV, you will get a list that will work forever, trust me. Member criteria. This is where I say who the rule applies to. So in the case of the banned words, the curse words, we probably want everybody in our community to be subject to that, whether they're employees of ours accessing the community or our customers or our partners. But there might be some rules that maybe only apply to your customers, and this is where you would come in and create that criteria. So you could come in, you could name it, and then here's where I would go in and say they're my customers. Then I would just choose their profile, move it over, and I could toggle it down. And you can also, this is sort of based on that rate rule we were talking about, I could say I want everybody that's in this profile to be subject to the rule, but maybe I only want it to be when they're a new user, or just until the point that they've actually posted something. So once you've got your content and you've got your member, then you go to the moderation and you actually put the two together. You choose whether it's content-based, rate-based, name it, remember to activate, put in your custom message and choose what the moderation action is. Cool. I'm sorry? I don't know how to turn it off. Isn't that embarrassing? I'm a Salesforce expert, but nothing else. I don't know anything else. Okay. Oops. Good thing this is being recorded forever. I don't know how to use toggle. Okay. I think I said everything here. Okay. This is a good tip, though. So if you already have the community, then you won't have those pre-canned moderation rules that we just saw. Those are only four communities that get turned on after the spring. So if you already had a community turned on and you want to check out those rules, just spin up a new dev org and turn on communities in there. You'll get them, and then you can just borrow them. All right. Content targeting. So whenever we have people accessing our community for the first time, we want to make sure that they've got some topics to sort of draw their attention, sort of explain what it is that this is all about. And the best way to do that is to have navigational topics on that left-hand side menu so that you can organize the content. And then you'll just be creating the topics that people will be posting their questions around. A little typo in there. Okay. So quick limitation on that. You can have up to 25 topics at the first level, which are parent topics, and then you can have up to 10 topics at level 2, and then up to 10 topics more at level 3. I personally think that's a lot to give somebody right at the beginning. I've found a lot of success in just creating just that top tree. You know, what are the 7 most important topics in your business that you would want your customers to access? Start there, and then maybe add to that tree. Because otherwise people log in for the first time and they can be really overwhelmed if you give them too much to do on the first day. All right. So then the next part is how to actually go in and add topics. So we're gonna go to the content targeting section within the builder or community workspace. And then under topic management, we're gonna choose the different topics that we want posted. This is also gonna be where any of your users are creating new topics, you know, in Chatter they can just do a hashtag, type out their topic, just like Twitter or the success community, and it's going to create a new topic for them. So you see here, we have a lot of very similar topics that people are contributing, and so your moderators, can go in and choose, maybe the official topic is Be Like Moyes. And so these are really similar, so I'm going to go tick these all off and just merge them, just to keep it decluttered. People can go see the Be Like Moyes topic, and they'll get to see all the other contributions that were related to these similar but not quite their topics. And then recommendations are the second piece of helping guide your customer community users as soon as they log in. It's actually like a little pop-up video or text that you can type out. It'll just pop up as like a help, like, want to know where to go? Or I recommend you do this the first time. You can link videos. You can send them links to maybe training that you might have somewhere else on your website. You can tell them to sign up for events. This is a really cool feature that I think everyone should be utilizing at the very beginning, and then anytime you make a change to the community, call their attention to it with a recommendation, and it really helps kind of smooth out those onboarding issues that you might have or adoption issues going forward. All right. So here's my watch out on this one, though. So I thought it was really cool, so I immediately started using it, and then I did it wrong. All right, so the audiences for recommendations, you can actually choose who are the people that are going to get these little pop-ups to use. And there's two options. You can choose new members or a custom list. So I thought, well, I'm a pretty unique person. I need a custom list. Custom list is actually what it says. It's custom. You can only access the custom lists over the API, and I'm not a developer, so that immediately stopped me. So the only recommendations I can do declaratively are with new members. So I will call out to just please vote for this idea. This is an idea to make the custom list something that's clickable instead of codable. And I think hopefully it'll be coming really soon. But for right now, only new members are going to see your recommendations. So that's the first time they log into the community. They're going to have these little help videos. All right, let's do some stuff. So we're going to make some navigational topics. These are the topics that I want people to navigate to. And then featured topics, you would choose from your navigational topics. You can pick one of them. And then what you can actually do is assign an image to it. And then on the homepage of your community, there's actually a featured topics component you can drag on so that the topic itself will be displayed with the word and then the logo that you just uploaded. We're going to just stick with navigational topics, but I'll show you the featured topics component while we're in there. And then recommendations, we're going to make one. Okay. Let's see what kind of cool pictures we have on my computer. This is my work computer, so it should be pretty safe. Yeah, that kind of fits with the theme. Okay, so we're going to just enable this, and then here's where you see the description, kind of what it's going to look like, and you can preview it, but we're just going to go fast and loose. We're just going to save this. So, URL. Okay. Cool. That'll be a really fun treat for us when we log into the community. So now we're going to go build this bad boy. So the first thing that you want to do is know these things. You can't hurt this. Click everything. There's not a ton of documentation around how to use this builder and what all the components do, and so I just grabbed them and started clicking on them. Do have some caution, though, before you publish, because publishing is what actually makes it available to community users. So if you already activated your community, as soon as you publish it, people will actually see that I hate Toggle right now, and I don't want that. So this would be something to do only in the sandbox first. If you haven't yet activated your community, then I think you could do it in production. Just exercise caution. You know your own use cases. Because I will say deployments from sandbox to production for community are really tricky. So we have some tips on that in a little bit. And actually, really heavy-handed, technical, step-by-step cooking recipes, because I had a deployment that went disastrously. So I don't want that to happen to you guys. Okay. But we're talking about the builder right now. So whenever we go to the builder, we are going to have these pages that are already set out for us straight out of the box. And I just want to talk about the most important features for them. So the first thing is in the top left corner, you have where it says home. When you click on it, you see all your pages. To the right of them, there's this teeny tiny gear, not to be confused with this other teeny tiny gear right here. So teeny tiny gear up here is how you can change your page layouts. Extremely handy. I didn't see that for like 3 weeks, and I was pulling all my hair out. Then you can set page variation with these little dots. So if you hover over the page itself, then you can click the dots. And what that does is actually really cool. I can make a custom home page for my customers with this profile, and then I can make a custom home page for my customers with this profile. And I don't have to do anything with crazy record types or whatever else. I just come click those little three dots, and then I just tell them what profile it is. Then standard pages in the template are all here. And if you don't really see what you want, there's this blue button here that says new page. Whoops, that we kind of ran out of viewing on. There you go. That was worth it, right? It says new page. Okay. And then once you click that, you can set up your new page, you choose your templates, you can make it say whatever you want, you can call it whatever you want, completely custom, but you can still use all of the standard components that we have out of the box. I worked so hard getting that box on the page, I want you to see it. Okay. So these are all of the clicks, not the code. So these are all of the things on day one that you have available as a component that you just drag and drop onto the builder. And you can really go the distance with this. If you want to make a customer community that handles support, questions and answers, and knowledge, I think you can get this thing done and live without the need of custom development. Now, I put little asterisks next to the things that you can only use if you actually have them enabled. That makes sense. All right, homepage. Branding. So when you're on the homepage, the things that you have to do are update the banner and add your company logo. And then I personally believe you should change the text case to capitalize instead of uppercase. So I'll show you when we get to the builder. Everything's defaulted to all caps, and it's like it's yelling at you. And it took me a while to find that, but I'll show you where it is. And then the branding color palette. As of Spring 17, you can actually set custom colors to each different page. Before, there was just a theme you would assign, and it was true on all of the pages. Now you can make custom ones by page, which is cool, but it also means be careful that you don't choose a slightly different shade of red on one page versus another. All right. Featured topics, we talked about that. I'm going to show you right now. But one of the things that I think you should do is get rid of the standard featured topics component that they give you on day one and actually swap it out for a component called tabs, because then you can customize what objects show up on that, really the most important part of the homepage. So let's just flip over. I'll show you. Boom. All right. Okay. So here it is out of the box, and because I already saved my recommendation, it's right there. You can move it around to different places. It's a component that's drag and drop, but I want to keep it right there for now. And then here is, this is what I was calling the banner at the top, and then when you drop your logo for your company, it's going to show up over here in the top left corner. And then each one of these, as I hover over, it highlights. This is a component I can customize. And once you have the component in the right spot, so like say I want to move the headline down. I don't know why I would, though. But you can move it. It glows green. That means you can drop it in that spot. Once you have it where you want, you click on it, and these little dialog boxes show up on the right, which is what you can do to customize it. And this auto saves. So as I make these changes, it's saved in this draft. It's still not been published to people, but if I were to close this session, go have lunch, I come back, log in, I'm gonna see all of the changes that I've made thus far. That's what I mean by auto saving. But to actually push it to your users and make it available to community users for, say, testing, they need to click publish. Before you're ready for that, you wanna click preview, because that's what lets you as the admin, while you're still in edit mode, come in and click on things and play with them. So you can see what these all do. And then you go back to the builder, and then you can make the edits based on what you're seeing. Okay, so here's the component that I always get rid of. It seems cool at first, but there's always something that you wanted to add that you can't when you're using this one. So there's featured, there's discussions, and then there's my feed. So featured are gonna be those featured topics if we had them. Discussions are questions and answers. People are talking around certain topics. And then my feed, of course, is my chatter feed like we have internally in Salesforce. So I like to just get rid of that whole thing. Yeah, I'm sure. And then I go to components, and here's where I have a ton. And I like tabs. Okay, here's why I like tabs. I can have more than three, which as soon as you find out you can have more than three, you immediately need like six. And then the trick here is you click on the tab that you're wanting to edit, and then you choose its label, you save it. And then while it's clicked and activated, you come down here, and then you can actually add in whatever it is that it's doing. So I'm gonna choose feed compact. And this is where you choose what it is that it's going to be displaying. So you could actually show bookmarks. You could show the user's profile, a specific topic, my feed, a group, or a record. So if you choose group or record, then you want to drop the ID. In the case of a chatter group, you could have them, just the first thing they see is maybe the customer community chatter group. So you would just drop in that chatter group's ID, which is, when you go to Salesforce and you've got the URL slash some 15-digit ID, when you're on the chatter group, it's gonna start OF9. That's the thing that you drop in here. And then it just filters all of the chatter feed to only show that one group. All right. I'm telling you guys, it's easy. Other things you can do, you have the ask question, and if you scroll down, there's also this widget called contact support and ask buttons. So I will say, out of the box, Napili is meant for support as much as it is about questions and answers and collaboration. So if you were staging your rollout and you don't want to start with support, you maybe just want it to be a place for your users to communicate with each other, then I would update all of these components to remove the one that says contact support. And I would just use only the ask button. So as you scroll down, there's one that's just called ask. And you can also change what it says. So when you click on it, you can change the label to whatever it is that you want it to be. Okay. And this obviously looks amazing, so I'm just gonna publish it. Yeah. What did I forget? How to change the font. Okay. So when you come to the branding editor, here's where you choose all of your colors. And you can choose, the text color should be this. No, whoa, should be black. The action color, those are gonna be the buttons. Link color, so it can be the hyperlinks, so on and so forth. And then this is where you add your company logo. The header image is that big gray bar at the top. We have a better one. I don't think that I do. All right. Primary font. So here you can actually choose the type of font that gets displayed. And then here's the most important part. I'm just going to default to capitalize. Oops, excuse me, uppercase. See, it's all uppercase. I like capitalize better. Now, if you're one of those people who forgets to capitalize things properly, then you might want to leave it as all uppercase, because then that corrects it for you. Then it's done. All right, so while that's going, next thing. As you're using the builder and you go to certain pages and you start dragging things on, they're gonna load in live, real time. They're gonna give you a preview, and sometimes you'll see this scary message at the top that says, we can't load this page because it's missing some underlying data. You're not gonna know what that means. It's one of two things. Either you don't have any records that it's trying to reference, so let's say you're using the article detail page, but you don't have knowledge on. You're not going to have any knowledge articles. It's going to have a hard time because it's actually trying to reference and filter the records real time. So to get that message to go away, actually add whatever it is it's talking about. It's really common in new Salesforce orgs. You don't have any chatter posts yet. So anytime you're working on a question or answer page, it's going to be blank and it's going to give you these errors, which means you can't test with it. So go in and make a sample record first. And then the second reason you're going to get this error is if you have a completely blank page. It's like it doesn't know what to do, and it's just like, I can't load this page. So just put one component on there to get that error to go away. Another example is if we talked about that group ID for the chatter group. If it can't find the group ID, or maybe you haven't added it yet, it's going to give you the same error, because it's trying to filter everything and show you what you want to see. So if you don't tell it everything, it can't show it. Watch out. Okay. Locker service is a great security feature that absolutely has to happen. But in the meantime, if you're in a sandbox or a DE org in Spring 17 now, you're going to get an error message whenever you try to add a rich text editor to the page. It's just for us admins. When you drag it onto the page on the builder, you get this scary message that's like, choose your fate. Have a rich text editor, or just, you know, make your company vulnerable to the security risk. So I will say, it's not a thing in production. It's a known issue. And so just right now, go disable it, because it's only in a sandbox or developer org that this is happening. And it's going to be auto-enabled in the Summer 17 release, at which point it'll be fixed. So it just presents a testing issue if you're in the sandbox and you have locker service turned on. And there's the link. Okay. 40. All right, I'm going to go through this pretty quickly. Here's the big deal. So when you are in your community and you're finally ready to publish it, let's say you did everything in the sandbox you were supposed to, there's this great thing under developer called export a solution. And it's this thing called Bolt Solutions that then show up in the setup menu. And whenever you go to spin up a new community, if you've already exported this template configuration, it becomes a new brick, like we saw at the very beginning of the presentation. We had the tiles for Aloha and Kakua and Napili and Visual Force Page and Tabs. You get your own that you can custom call whatever you want. I hate toggle, whatever. So that sounded like the thing that I wanted to do in order to move this solution out of a sandbox into production. I exported the solution, and then it creates an unmanaged package, which is a URL link that you can go then install in the target org. The problem with an unmanaged package when you're trying to move from a sandbox into production is there's no prefix in the namespace, so all of the custom fields and objects are going to be replicated, and so the package won't get deployed. So then you're left with having to change all of the names in production to something different to get the package in and then change them all back, which essentially is taking your org down for several days. So don't do this. What you instead want to do is, not this, it's language, I'm going to find it. Okay, I'm going to read my instructions. Under advanced pages, go to site.com studio, there we go. Pages, site.com studio. So for anyone who worked on communities in the very early days, this will look pretty familiar to you. This is kind of like the community before it got the really pretty user interface. So you come here. Assets are the images that you would have uploaded. And then the gear over here in the top right. You're going to first export the site assets, and then you're going to export this site. It's going to take all of the configuration that you saved in the builder, every component that you've done, where it goes, and then it's going to package it up into a file that you just save locally on your computer. Let's not open it then. Okay. And then when you're ready to import it, you come to the target org, say production, you go back to the site.com studio, and then you choose overwrite this site, and then you choose the file that you just exported. And you click overwrite. So it's not as fun as a change set, but it'll actually work. Now the Bolt solutions, if you were to do everything in a community in a developer org, then you could use this unmanaged package to move it into production. But if you're using one of your own sandboxes, you're not going to be able to use the Bolt solution. Okay. And I have, it's just step by step by step how to do this because it was a mess when it didn't work. Finally, code not clicks. So for anybody who's interested in making custom components for communities, I had heard that they were really easy, but they're not. And so I actually went to this developer site, this crazy like components configuration for the builder theme layout, and just completely freaked out. Well, then I found Pluralsight. So if you're like me and you're not a developer by trade, but you're interested in making your own components, I would go find Sarah Morgan. She has a lot of helpful advice. I think she does a really great job of explaining it. And then you can also sign up for Pluralsight and take her class. And then what you can do is end up making your own pages with Lightning components that say embed Wave Analytics. So if you wanted to, you could expose your customer community users to Wave, and you can just throw the page right in. And then it lets them come in and explore it, do whatever they want with it. And once you know what you're doing, you can get this done in probably 30 minutes.
Do they have a Wave license?
They do. Okay. Yeah. And also, I should have preferenced, you also need to have customer community licenses to use this. That's not a thing that you get free. Okay, 1 minute. I'm sorry, y'all. Questions? Yeah?
The moderation rules, that Wave, does it still allow the posting?
It does.
And Wave it?
Yes.
Okay, so it's not like a review that they have to approve it before it actually.
Right, review is the one that has to be reviewed. Flagged is just, we let it pass, but we're going to tell somebody about it. I have. Yeah. There's a global community setting. Now I don't know where I am. Oh my goodness. I can do this. Thank you. All right. Where do I get back to my, oh geez Louise. Oh, I just saw it. Salesforce setup, that's what it's called. Okay. If you go into community, I think it's settings. Oh, no, it's in sharing settings, regular sharing settings. There's a button to allow community users to see each other. If you uncheck that, then they won't be able to see each other. Right there. Any other questions? Cool. All right, well, enjoy your day. You stay and help me with Toggle.